It's an ordinary weekday evening in Manchester for Bobbi, Neuman and her grandchildren. As her name suggests, in some ways she's the archetypal Jewish grandma.
I would describe my mother as a very selfless, loving, very, very warm, incredible. She is my hero, actually, my mother.
Bobbi is my Bobbi, and I've always lived with Bobbi since I was born. And I feel a very, very close connection with my grandmother.
My mother has certain very admirable qualities, which are difficult to find elsewhere.
But behind the happy exterior lies a difficult past, which Bobbi kept to herself for over 60 years.
I was born in Czechoslovakia in 1939. It was a little Jewish town, and more than 50% was Jewish, and even the non-Jews spoke Yiddish.
I can't remember I was unhappy with a very loving family. I think if you come from a happy home, a loving home, the rest of the life is much easier.
But soon, political events in neighboring Germany started to intrude. After the Nazis came to power, the spirit of fascism infected the entire continent with hatred of Jews.
I remember that all the buses from Israel, which was, thinking of it now, the tragedy. It was, he lied beautifully and he sang beautifully, and the whole suicide of everyone was crying. And I couldn't understand why people cried at the Bar Mitzvah. But it was the beginning of really things going wrong.
September 1st, 1939, the weather perfect for mechanized warfare, Hitler unleashed his blitz fleet.
In the years that followed, persecution intensified. Its ultimate expression was to be the final solution, a plan for the annihilation of Jews across Europe.
Soldiers came in. Black shirts and not just two or three, but quite a few of them, just like occupied every room and taking all our jewelry and maybe take all what I had on, take it off. And they said, everybody can take a case, what you can carry, not more, because they're going to work. So we marched to the shul, all the townspeople came to the shul, and that was starting to be really very emotional and very, everybody down in the shouting, and we didn't know, you know, they're not knowing, not knowing what now.
We are taken to the station and we have to climb up in these wagons. I think about between 80 and 100 people pushed in there.
I don't know exactly how long we were in these wagons. 3 days, I think.
Men and women together, children crying. It was indescribable.
After a grueling journey, finally they came to Auschwitz.
We arrived in Auschwitz and they opened the gates. And hundreds of thousands of people all over said we should get out. And it was all striped uniforms. There were the couples who organized the whole thing there with the SS men together. But they were the helpful who pushed us out and told us where to go. And all of a sudden, I'm standing in a group and my mother was there. And my brothers were there. And nobody was there. I was on my own. So I started screaming and the couple came out and said to my friends, come on, come down, she's not allowed to shout. And that was it. Never saw them again.
Bobbi's mother and siblings were already on their way to their death in the gas chambers. They were among 2 million people slaughtered at Auschwitz by the end of the war. Only those like Bobbi, fit enough to work, were allowed to live. It was many years before Bobbi could bring herself to talk about these painful experiences.
You didn't speak, you didn't, and nobody spoke. I always thought I don't speak, but nobody spoke. For 60 years I never mentioned, I never told my husband, I never told my children.
The odd story, you saw the time, you know, the numbers on the arm, but it was meaningless to us. We didn't know anything. We were never taught anything.
Unlike many survivors, she was never frightened to display her tattoo. She didn't do it purposely, but she always sort of used to roll up her sleeves because she worked hard, and that's how she ran the household. The fact that she'd had a terrible experience during the war just didn't occur to us.
She only started talking about it when I got married, and David started talking to her about it. And we didn't know much about it, of course. No one did in those days. In fact, Leb tried to book her to go to Auschwitz, and we said, Leb, you're crazy. She doesn't want to go to Auschwitz. Why are you doing that?
My grandson, Daniel Goldberg, came to me and said, would you like to go to Auschwitz? Would I like to go to Auschwitz? No way. I thought he's lost it.
The combination of Daniel and Daniel Rowe told her that she should go back because the next generation has to know what happened. And then Daniel came to say, you know, we should go to Auschwitz.
I said, all right, I'll try. Because he's such a wonderful kid that if I tell him to jump off the roof, he would say, no problem. How can I refuse him? It's not possible. So I went.
Bobbi returned to Auschwitz for the first time in 2006, along with granddaughter Esther. She's come to Poland on a mission to tell her story to a new generation.
The sky lit up by fire because the tin is all burning.
When you walk around someone who can point out certain places, they can say, this is where I slept, this is where I worked, this is where I was beaten, this is where we were fed off, morsel of bread and tangle of water, brings everything to reality.
For me personally, I was always experiencing what she went through whilst we were walking through Auschwitz. It was just surreal.
I took it much better than I expected to take it. They were all very nice to me. They all helped me to get over this feeling. It didn't affect me the way I thought it would affect me.
Astonishingly, there is a photographic record of Bobby's arrival in 1944. The only pictures ever taken of Jewish deportees arriving at the extermination camp were compiled in the Auschwitz album. Bobbi can be clearly seen on the day her train pulled in.
I was with all the women just going to the bars. They had tattoos, they were given clothes, nothing warm, and it was very, very cold. And all of a sudden I saw somebody with a striped uniform. He must have gone first to get changed or passed or whatever. And it looked funny that this trousers were too short, this sleeves were too short. In my mind, I thought that could be my father because he was very tall. And I picked my head up and it is my father. Now, this was after the shaving, so he didn't recognize me. I recognized him and I spoke to him and said, Daddy, what is this flame bottle and this chimney doing? So my father, don't worry about it. Look how many people there are here. They're probably the breaking bread or something, that's why. Did he know what it was? I don't know. And when we got on the last one, just said, you have to be strong, you have to be strong, and you have to survive. Remember, you've got to look after yourself, because you have to look after mommy and the boys and get. Yeah. And the next day, you have to get up at 3 o'clock to do the counting. It's called the sailor. I think there was still snow, just remember, tremendous cold. And we didn't have zombies we did it, we went. I still got up for ages, very, very cold. And then there was one person who was there before us, and he just started whispering to us what's going to happen. Don't faint, don't sit down, don't move, don't do this, don't do that. And keep on pinching your cheeks. So that you should look healthy, because if you don't look healthy, they don't need you for work. We got into this bed somehow, and then a couple would come and beat you, and the pain was tremendous, it's very painful. And you just try to shiver up into a small little bundle that they shouldn't see you. When you came to your bread, somebody else took it. You had no other soul except heart to survive.
The complex of gas chambers and crematoria was run with ruthless efficiency. using prisoners to marshal the victims and to sort out their possessions. That was the task Bobbi was assigned to. The place she worked was nicknamed Canada.
This is where I work. And we collected the coals and sorted it. And eventually we got something, a small piece of bread and a bowl of so-called soup. And the work was very, very hard and very military. You had to be exact and mustn't talk and mustn't think. And then all of a sudden, you're hungry. You know, when is the next meal? But there is no next meal. That was the meal.
She was then reassigned to work outside the crematorium itself. Today, all that remains of the building is a pile of bricks.
This is very funny. I haven't been to this one for 7 years. And not very pleasant. This was one of the rooms where the people arrived to go to the crematorium. And they came inside, they got undressed in one of the rooms. And we came in after they left that room and went to the next room. And we kept on picking his clothes and all their belongings, you know, big sheet, knocking them up and taking them to the barracks to be sorted. And as they were going up to the next room, if we heard them say Schmeiß word, all in one, all of them together, that was the most part of the work, which was a relief because we knew we're not suffering anymore, it's over. And to think of it that we could say that. And one day I saw a queue going into the crematorium, and one of them was my grandmother. And she said to me, "Where's mommy?" So I said, "Mommy's gone in there, and you will go in there, and you'll be together."
In early 1945, with the Allies closing in, the SS decided to evacuate Auschwitz, destroying the evidence of their handiwork. Any prisoner fit enough to walk was force-marched through the snow on the infamous Death March. As they progressed, those too weak to continue were shot or left for dead.
There was a lady who was 42 years old, and she asked me if she could walk with me. So she was leaning on me all the time. And she was helpful to me too, because you know you can't sleep walking if you've got somebody to lead you. So we took turns occasionally to have a little of sleep, walking sleep. And I knew if I stop, she will also stop. And that would be the end of both of us. And I couldn't take this responsibility.
But as the Russian army approached to liberate them, the weakened prisoners were struck by a fierce typhus epidemic. Soon Bobbi became sick and was given up for dead.
In the morning, whoever was alive had to take the bodies out. But there was nobody on the way to take them. So just put them outside and was like a mountain of bodies out there. But I was told this story. I wasn't conscious anymore. And then the Russians came in, and it was somebody like a general or somebody higher. And it seems I slipped down and I walked away. So this first man came, picked my hand up to push me away, and he said, "Oh, she's still alive." So they brought a stretcher and they took me to the hospital. And this fellow came every day and looked after me and told the nurses what to do. When I got a bit better one day, he came in and looked around, there was nobody around, and he bent down to me and he said, "He's a doctor, he's a Jew."
Eventually, Bobbi married and settled in Manchester, where she still lives, surrounded by her children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren.
It was a dream that I would get married. And when I got married, it was a dream that I had children, and I still think it's all a miracle somehow. Because we never expected it, we never dreamed it.
We had a very happy childhood. It was always giving. Very little expected back. My own and my own family's and my sister's and brother's experience now, because as a mother, it's not as a concentration camp survivor.
Depression is something to be put as a version to it. It's not
on top of that.
There's never been
to
that
for me. People usually say to me,
do you hate the Germans? Obviously, I suppose you hate the Germans, and I probably am, but I'm fighting that feeling of hate, because hate is a destruction in his own self.
I think the dedication to bringing us up and to self-sacrifice must have been a reflection of her survival, really.
70 years old, I don't know. And that is not the way that I find out in the life that I think that how did I do it? The only thing you have to have is Hashem. Somebody asked me this, to be fair with Hashem, then you are in
When I was growing up, I never really understood what Auschwitz was all about. And then I think my grandmother wanted to find me a technique because I feel so like close to her. And I think she wanted me to have a sense maybe to pass on to like my children and realize what she went through.
And I'm glad that it is. And I'm very glad that I do it for other people. And my belief in life was that if you do things for other people, you're not busy. You forget yourself because you're busy doing it for others.
I feel a huge responsibility to understand what my grandmother went to and be able to tell my kids what.
When somebody said I'm going back to office, my person is obviously. I couldn't stop it because I could see it. But you're doing something that is worthwhile doing.
The most powerful message that I get from Bobbi and feel from Bobbi is that if you always believe that this is going to happen and I'm going to make the best of the situation no matter what, because it was in such critical conditions, and she just kept on going and kept on pushing until it was the end, and she succeeded. She built an amazing family and she won it.
To me, my family is the most precious thing in the world. I don't want diamonds, I want them, and I want them to be happy because my family is to me the best in the world.